Every NBA team has a long history filled with all-stars and legendary NBA players. So for today's video, we are going to rank the top 10 players from every NBA team all time. Now before we do that, I do have one quick rule. I am only factoring what the player has done for that specific team, or their current talent status if they have completed at least one season. Take for example Dwayne Wade. Wade is a Miami Heat legend and likely the third best shooting guard ever. He did play a half season in Cleveland when he was 36 years old. I don't think it's fair to say that Wade was one of the greatest Cavs of all time. He is, however, one of the greatest Heat players ever. So once you understand this rule, we can rebound onto that list. This is obviously an extremely long video, so if you just want to learn about specific teams, check the description for timestamps for every team within this video. Coming in 10th place, we have Ben Simmons. If Ben spends more seasons in Philly, he will likely end up higher on this list. He ranks towards the bottom of the top 10 due to his young age. At 9th place is Joel Embiid. Joel comes in 9th for similar reasons why Ben comes in 10th. By the end of their careers, if they don't get traded, they could end up higher. Now the real question is, why do I currently have Joel ahead of Ben? This is definitely a close call, but Joel has one more All-Star appearance and one more postseason appearance. Landing in 8th place is Chet Walker. Chet spent 6 seasons in Philly. He is a 3-time Philly All-Star, 7-time total, and won a championship with Philly in 1967. That season was also his best Philly season, scoring over 19 points per game. Ranking in at 7th place is Maurice Cheeks. Mo Cheeks spent the majority of his career on the 76ers and won a chip with them in 1982. He's a 4-time All-Star, but more specifically, a 5-time All-Defensive player. On paper, averaging 12 points per game doesn't seem impressive, but when you break down his game, his defense and playmaking is to be noted. He also has his jersey retired in Philadelphia. Coming in at 6th place is Billy Cunningham. Billy won a chip in Philly in 67 and averaged 18 points per game in that season. He's a 5-time Philly All-Star and 4-time All-NBA player. At 5th place, we have Charles Barkley. Sir Charles is most certainly an NBA legend, and if Philadelphia didn't have such a rich, deep history of NBA legends, Charles would have easily landed number one on so many other teams. In 4th place, we have Moses Malone. Now, Moses only did play 5 seasons in Philly, but you can argue that these were some of his best seasons. He won both an MVP and a Finals MVP in Philly, and obviously a chip. Had he spent more time on the 76ers, he would easily be higher on this list. Would have ranked higher than AI. Coming in 2nd place, we have Dr. J, Julius Erving. As far as the NBA goes, Dr. J is a Philly lifer. He won an NBA MVP in 1981 and a ring in 1983. If we're comparing overall careers, it's a close call between Dr. J and Moses Malone, but again, Malone's time in Philly was a bit too short. And in 1st place, hopefully to no one's surprise, we have Wilt Chamberlain. Now the real debate should be if Wilt should be remembered as a 76er or a Warrior. He technically is both. He played for both the Philadelphia Warriors and the Philadelphia 76ers during his career. Of course, also the Lakers. He was a Warrior from 1959 to 1965 and a 76er from 1965 to 1968. He also has a jersey retired for both teams. Now on to the Bucks. Coming in 10th place, we have Chris Middleton. Chris so far spent 7 seasons in Milwaukee and made 2 All-Star games so far. He could end up higher on the list if he finishes his career here and continues to improve his game. In 9th place, we have Terry Cummings. Terry is a 2-time Bucks All-Star and a 2-time All-NBA player while wearing a Bucks jersey. You can argue that Chris has spent more seasons on the Bucks, but you could also argue that Terry did more in less time. But again, if Chris continues his game, he could end up higher on this list. Landing in 8th place is Glenn Robinson. Glenn spent 8 seasons on the Bucks and averaged over 21 points per game during his time there. He is a 2-time Bucks All-Star and made the All-Rookie team on the Bucks. He was a number 1 overall pick, so he did have a lot of pressure on him. But he did lead the Bucks as their leading scorer in 2001 all the way to the Eastern Conference Finals, which is why I have him ahead of Chris and Terry. At 7th place, we have Sidney Moncrief. If we don't count his single post-retirement return season in Atlanta, technically Sidney was a Bucks lifer during his first stunt playing 10 seasons in Milwaukee. Moncrief is in the Hall of Fame as a 5-time All-Star and 5-time All-NBA player. He is also a 5-time All-Defensive player and 2-time Defensive Player of the Year. Coming in 6th place is Bob Dandridge. Bob had a really underrated career. And I get it, when you're on the same roster as Kareem Abdul-Jabbar and Big O Oscar Robertson, it's easy to let those two names get all of the attention. Bob is a 3-time Bucks All-Star, and in his best Bucks season, he averaged over 20 points per game, and during his championship run, he averaged over 18 points per game. In 5th place, we have Ray Allen. Had Ray spent more time on the Bucks, I could see him being a little higher, but the competition does get really tough going forward. That is not to disregard Ray's epic run while on the Bucks. Even though he only played 7 seasons, he holds 2 franchise records for most 3-point field goals at 1,051 and most threes in a single season at 229. He made 2 All-Star games and an All-NBA team while on the Bucks. His deepest run was the Eastern Conference Finals. In 4th place, we have Marquez Johnson. Now, you're probably wondering why I have Johnson ahead of Sidney, and I will admit, Sidney is the better defender. But let's not assume that Marquez is some defensive scrub. He came in the top 20 defensive win shares for multiple seasons and was a more efficient player scorer and got similar amounts of assists despite being a forward. Landing in 3rd place, we have the Big O Oscar Robertson. Now, Oscar only spent 4 seasons on the Bucks, his final 4, but that doesn't mean he had a really impressive run. He made 2 All-Star games, obviously winning the championship, and even in his old age, came 5th in triple-doubles compared to the entire league. At 2nd place, we have the Greek freak of nature, Giannis Antetokounmpo. Giannis so far is a 2-time MVP, Defensive Player of the Year, and if he spends his entire career here and eventually maybe pulls off a chip, it might be possible he can take that number one spot, but only time will tell. Coming in 1st place, we have Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Kareem only played 6 seasons on the Bucks, but he is one of the GOATs of the entire sport, and his run in Milwaukee was certainly legendary, winning 2 scoring titles, Rookie of the Year, 3 MVPs, a Finals MVP, and of course that chip. Moving on, we have the Bulls, and in 10th place, we have a bit of a Bull-E, Joakim Noah, no pun intended. Now, if you just glance over his stats, you probably wouldn't put him on this list, but if you really watched his game, you know that his time in Chicago was really talented. He was a defensive nightmare, and won plenty of awards for it. The 2-time All-Star has 3 All-Defensive listings, and even 1 Defensive Player of the Year in 2014. At 9th place, we have Luol Deng. In many ways, Deng was the backbone of the Bulls for a good decade. Yes, during many of these years, Derrick Rose ran the show, but Deng was a great defensive piece and second option for the team. He is a 2-time All-Star and an All-Defensive Player in Chicago. Coming in 8th place, we have Horace Grant. Grant played an important role for 3 of those Bulls titles, as he was a defensive anchor in Phil Jackson's triangle. The 3-time Bulls champ is also a 1-time All-Star and an All-Defensive Player. Speaking of defensive anchors for Phil's triangle system, in 7th place, we have the one and only Dennis Rodman. Rodman only spent 3 seasons in Chicago, and while he wasn't much of a scorer, he was a rebounding and defensive machine, averaging 15 rebounds per game. He is a 3-time Bulls champ, 3-time total rebound champ, and an All-Defensive Player. Before MJ entered the league in 84, coming in 6th place, we have Reggie Theus holding the fort down in Chicago. He is a 2-time Bulls All-Star and Bulls All-Rookie player, and while his resume isn't as deep as other players on this list, being able to help take a weaker Bulls team to the playoffs is pretty impressive before MJ came to town. For similar reasons why Reggie gets 6th, Artis Gilmore lands in 5th place. Artis is a 4-time Bulls All-Star and helped lead the Bulls to 2 playoff appearances. He is also a Bulls All-Defensive Player and averaged over 20 points per game as a Bull. Landing in 4th place is Chet Walker. Chet spent his last 6 seasons as a Bull and had plenty of success, averaging over 20 points per game, made 4 All-Star games, and helped lead the Bulls to the playoffs all 6 times. The battle for 3rd and 2nd place on this team is one of the hardest choices in this video. Derrick Rose versus Scottie Pippen. Rose is the youngest MVP in NBA history. His talent when he was healthy was unmatched. Rose is a three-time Bulls All-Star, All-NBA player, MVP, and Rookie of the Year. Had Rose spent more seasons in Chicago, made the finals, not necessarily win the ring, but at least got to the finals, I would have had him ahead of Scottie. Speaking of Scottie, in second place, we have Scottie Pippen. First off, let's talk about talent. Rose is definitely the more offensively gifted player compared to Scottie, but I think the gap between Scottie's defense is much higher than the gap between Rose's offense. Scottie spent 12 seasons in Chicago, Rose only spent 7. Scottie has 7 all-defensive first teams on the Bulls and 8 total in Chicago. And of course, those 6 rings do play a factor. Sure, MJ was the main reason why those exist, but it is important to note that Scottie in many ways was the missing piece to the puzzle for Jordan to fully flourish his game. And hopefully, to no one's surprise, the best Chicago Bulls player is the GOAT of the sport. In first place, we have Michael Jeffrey Jordan. And now onto the rock and roll capital of the world, Cleveland, Ohio, with the Cavaliers. Coming in 10th place, we have a lot of really close calls. Some great choices include Craig Elo, Bingo Smith, Big Z, and even Colin Sexton makes really close runner-ups for that 10th spot. I am going with Elo, and now Elo is probably most known for the infamous shot from Michael Jordan, but let's not forget that Elo hit what could have been the game-winning shot just 3 seconds left before that iconic shot. And this 90s Cavs squad is one of the most underrated teams in NBA history. Yes, history is written by the winners, but before MJ went on his historic run, Elo's defense and three-point shooting was a part of a very impressive Cavs unit. Coming in 9th place, we have Sean Kemp. Sean only spent 3 seasons in the land of Klee, but he still put up great numbers and made an all-star team. He averaged over 18 points per game and helped lead the team to 1 playoff appearance. Had he spent more time or been to more playoffs for the Cavs, he would have placed higher. Landing in 8th place, we have Ron Harper. Ron is a 5-time champ, but that's when he was on the Bulls averaging around 7 points per game. He spent his first 4 seasons on the Cavs and put up an impressive 19 points per game and helped lead the Cavs to 2 playoff appearances. In 7th place, we have Kevin Love. If Kevin was healthier or led the Cavs to the playoffs alone in a post-LeBron era, he would rank higher. He is a 2-times Cavs All-Star and champ, but while being a part of that big 3, he was limited to a catch-and-shoot 3-point shooter. Still, that shouldn't take away from the fact that without his efforts, Cleveland would not be a championship city. At 6th place, we have Mr. Cavalier himself, Austin Carr. Austin spent most of his career in Cleveland, playing 9 seasons with the Cavs, is an All-Star, and led them to 3 playoff appearances. In his best Cavs season, he averaged almost 22 points per game. Coming in 5th place, we have Larry Nance Sr. Larry is a 2-time Cavs All-Star, 2-time defensive second team, and all-defensive first team Cavalier. He is known for his amazing double dunks during All-Star weekend, and while in Cleveland, he averaged almost 17 points per game. In 4th place, we have one of the best centers in Cavs history, Brad Doherty. Brad is a Cavs lifer, spending all 8 seasons in Cleveland. He made an All-NBA team, 5 All-Star teams, and co-led the Cavs to 5 playoff appearances, averaging around 19 points per game and almost 10 rebounds per game. In 3rd place, we have Uncle Drew, the Pepsi Max King, Kyrie Irving. Kyrie spent his first 6 seasons in Cleveland and averaged over 25 points per game in his highest scoring Cleveland season. He is a 3-time Cavs All-Star, Rookie of the Year, All-NBA player, and a Cavs champ who hit the shot of shots in Game 7 of the Finals. Landing in 2nd place, we have one of the most underrated players in NBA history, Mark Price. Mark spent most of his career in Cleveland, playing his first 9 seasons there. Mark is a part of the 50-40-90 club. That's over 50% from the field, 40% from 3, and 90% from the free throw line. Mark is a 4-time Cavs All-Star, 4-time All-NBA player, averaged almost 20 points per game in his best season, and around 17 points per game overall in Cleveland. He led this team to 7 playoff appearances, and his deepest run was the 1992 Eastern Finals against the Bulls. He is also a 2-time 3-point champion. champion. Hopefully to no one's surprise, coming in first place besides Anthony Bennett since he's too good for this list, we have the Sprite Cranberry King, LeBron James. LBJ needs no explanation to why he ranks on top. Next up, we have the team tied with the most titles, the Boston Celtics. Coming in 10th place, we have Ray Allen. Ray spent 5 seasons in Boston, averaging around 17 points per game. While in Boston, Ray made 3 All-Star appearances and won a championship in 2008. In 9th place, we have Bob Cousy. Excluding his 1-point retirement season in Cincinnati when he was 41, Bob was pretty much a Celtics lifer. Bob is a 6-time champ, 12-time All-NBA player, regular season MVP, and 8-time regular season assist champion. If the Celtics weren't overloaded with legends, or if Bob played in a tougher era, he would have easily landed higher on this list. But we do gotta take into account that there were so few teams during his era, which does factor into the amount of competition he had. Landing in 8th place is Robert Parrish. Cousy's resume might look better than Parrish's, but I think Robert dominated in a much harder era. The 80s and 90s, in my opinion, are some of the 2 toughest decades in NBA history, especially defensively. He won 3 titles with the Celtics and made 9 All-Star teams. At 7th place, we have the big ticket, Kevin Garnett. Garnett only spent 6 seasons in Boston, and his resume might look smaller than both Robert's and Bob's, but from a raw talent perspective, I think Garnett at his best is better than Robert at his best. I personally think that 2007-08 Garnett was the best of his prime. Yes, he won the MVP in 2004 and scored a few more points in that season, but 08 Garnett was far more efficient, had a higher basketball IQ, and was a much better defender as he won Defensive Player of the Year, and of course that chip does factor into things. Coming in 6th place, we have Dave Cowens. In Dave's MVP season, he played all 82 games and almost 42 minutes per game, excluding his 1 post-retirement season on the Bucks. He is technically a Celtics lifer who is a 2-time champ. He's had a long Celtics career, is a 2-time champ, MVP, 3-time All-NBA player, and Rookie of the Year. Bob's resume is a little longer than Dave's, but what Dave accomplished in the 70s and 80s, I personally think is a little more impressive than what Bob did in the 50s. In 5th place, we have the truth, Paul Pierce. Paul spent most of his career in Boston, his first 15 seasons. He is a 10-time All-Star, 4-time All-NBA player, a Finals MVP. Once again, with these Celtics rankings, it's easy to skim over resume and rank these guys like Paul and Garnett lower, but Paul at his best, I think, is an MVP-level player. In his best season, he put up almost 27 points per game while grabbing about 7 rebounds and 5 assists. I do think that Kevin Garnett is a more talented player overall, but in terms of Celtics greatness, Paul spent more time with the Celtics, and this was technically Paul's team during the 2000 Celtics Big 3 days. Coming in 4th place is John Havlicek. John is one of the greatest Celtics ever. He is a Celtics lifer who averaged 20 points per game throughout his career and almost 29 points per game in his best season. He is a 13-time All-Star, 8-time champ, 11-time All-NBA, 8-time All-Defensive, and Finals MVP. It's a close call between John and Kevin McHale at the 4th and 3rd spot. Speaking of 3rd, we have Kevin McHale. Kevin is a Celtics lifer, Hall of Famer, 7-time All-Star, 3-time champ, 6-time All-Defensive, and 2-time 6th man. John's resume is definitely longer, and I think this is a super close call between the two. Personally, I think Kevin having success at his level in possibly one of the toughest NBA decades is what gives him the slight edge, but it is indeed close. And then there were 2. Honestly, we can spend an entire video debating Bill versus for both. No one has a better resume than Bill, but if resumes were the end-all be-all for debates like these, Bill would be the runaway GOAT, and no one should ever think of mentioning Jordan or LeBron. But of course, there is more to the game than resumes, and I do think factoring eras are important. This is not to take away anything from the legendary Bill Russell, who is a 12-time champ. Leaving first place for Bird is the Word, Larry Bird. When Bill Russell played in the league, during his time and for some of his championships, his leagues had around 8 to 15 teams to compete against depending on the year, while Bird himself was in a solidified NBA with 30 teams. Bird had a lot more physical competition, pressure, and rivalries to go up against. Bird himself is a 3-time champ, 2-time Finals MVP, 3-time regular season MVP, and was a 12-time All-Star. are. Next up, we have the Clippers / Buffalo Braves, which are technically the same franchise. Coming in 10th place, we have Randy Smith. Randy spent 8 seasons with the Braves and even 1 season as a San Diego Clipper, 9 in total. He played all 82 games for 10 seasons straight, is a 2-time All-Star, and an All-NBA player. In 9th place, we have DeAndre Jordan. DeAndre spent his first 10 seasons with the Clippers, became an All-Star, 2-time All-Defensive player, and was a 2-time total rebound champ. In 8th place is Elton Brand. Elton played his first 7 seasons in LA, averaging over 20 points per game. He won Rookie of the Year, made an All-NBA team, and is a 2-time All-Star. He only made the playoffs once in LA, and had he gone to more trips, he could have ranked higher on this list. Landing in 7th place is World Be Free. He only spent 2 seasons with the Clippers, but they were monster seasons, averaging almost 30 points per game. His time with the Clippers also showcases his 1 All-Star appearance and his All-NBA second team selection. Coming in 6th place is Bill Walton. Bill missed 2 seasons due to injury and really only played for about 4 seasons with the Clippers. If he was healthier or played more on this team, he could have ranked higher. He is a Hall of Fame legend, of course. In 5th place, we have Paul George. While Paul's resume is really short and is something you would write off, his on-court talent is something that deserves to be factored in. And yes, Paul had a disappointing postseason, but there is no denying that Paul is a talented player and is still in his prime. He is an elite two-way player who is both a good scorer and defender. Ranking in 4th place, we have Blake Griffin. Blake is a slam dunk champion and spent his first 9 seasons in LA, averaging over 20 points per game, 1 Rookie of the Year, made 4 All-NBA teams, and 4 All-Star teams as a Clipper. In 3rd place, we have Chris Paul. Chris Paul spent 6 seasons with the Clippers and pretty much played the majority of his prime in LA, averaging almost 19 points per game and almost 10 assists per game. He made the All-Star team 5 times and All-NBA team 5 times. Coming in 2nd place, we have Kawhi Leonard. Now, Kawhi only spent 1 full season so far, but this was his highest scoring season at 27 points per game. He's 28 and in the peak of his prime. Kawhi is one of the best two-way players in the league. There is no denying his on-court talent. In 1st place, we have Bob McAdoo. Bob only played 5 seasons with the Braves, but these were monster seasons, averaging almost 30 points per game. He won an MVP, Rookie of the Year, and was an All-Star and All-NBA player with the Braves. Moving on, we have the Grizzlies. Coming in 10th place, we have Ja Morant. Yes, Ja only played 1 season so far, but I think he has a lot of raw talent and upside going forward. He won Rookie of the Year, averaging almost 18 points per game. If he spends more time in Memphis and continues to improve, I can easily see him ending up much higher on this list. In 9th place, we have OJ Mayo. OJ spent his first 4 seasons in Memphis, averaging 15 points per game, and in his best scoring season, over 18 points per game. OJ made the All-Rookie team and helped his team make 2 playoff appearances. Landing in 8th place is Shane Battier. Shane played 6 seasons with the Grizzlies, averaging a little over 10 points per game and over 14 points per game in his best season. If you just glance over his stats, you might write him off, but his time in Memphis was pretty impressive in terms of efficiency and defense. His defense and 14.3 defensive win shares played a major role in the Grizzlies making the playoffs 4 times. Coming in 7th place, we have Sharif Abdul-Rahim. Sharif spent 5 seasons with the Grizzlies, averaging over 20 points per game, and averaged a double-double in his 4th season with 10 rebounds and 20 points per game. In 6th place, we have Tony Allen. Tony played 7 seasons in Memphis, averaging around 9 points per game. He ranks high on this list thanks to his elite defense. He made 3 all-defensive first teams and 3 all-defensive second teams. That's 6 in total. This helped the Grizzlies make the playoffs 6 times. In 5th place ranks Rudy Gay. Rudy spent his first 7 seasons in Memphis, averaging almost 18 points per game and over 20 points per game in his best season. His scoring helped lead the Grizzlies to the playoffs by the time he was 25, and while he never made an All-Star team, he was usually snubbed, and I think he had the talent to definitely make one. Coming in 4th place, we have Pau Gasol. Pau played his first 7 seasons with the Grizzlies, averaging almost 19 points per game. He won Rookie of the Year, made an All-Star team with the Grizzlies, and helped lead them to the playoffs 3 times. Had he stayed on this team longer, he would have ranked higher. Landing in 3rd place, we have Mike Conley. Mike's resume may look a little short, but the 12 seasons he put into Memphis is not to be overlooked. In his best season, he averaged over 21 points per game, and he's an all-defensive player. He helped lead the Grizzlies to 6 playoff appearances, averaging almost 17 points per game in the playoffs and over 25 points per game in his best playoff season. In second place, we have the 04 Most Improved Player, Zach Randolph. Zach is a 2-time All-Star and an All-NBA player. Zach spent 8 seasons in Memphis, averaging around 17 points per game, and helped lead this team to the playoffs 7 times. In first place, we have Marc Gasol. Marc did some amazing things while in Memphis, winning Defensive Player of the Year, became an All-Star, and landed on All-NBA teams, and of course the All-Rookie team while averaging over 15 points per game and 7.7 rebounds. Next up, we have the Hawks. Coming in 10th place is Josh Smith. Josh spent 9 seasons in Atlanta, averaging over 15 points per game and over 18 points per game in his best season. Jace Move is also an all-defensive and all-rookie Hawk. In 9th place, we have Doc Rivers. Doc spent 8 seasons with the Hawks, averaging 13 points per game. He also made an all-star team while playing with the Hawks. Landing in 8th place, we have Al Horford. Al is a 4-time Hawks all-star, all-NBA player, and all-rookie. In his best season, he averaged over 18 points per game and led the Hawks to 8 playoff appearances. In 7th place, we have John Drew. John is a 2-time Hawks All-Star and All-Rookie player who averaged 21 points per game while playing for the Hawks. He helped lead the Hawks to 4 playoffs. I have John ahead of Al Horford because I think he was able to do more with less. Al had some really great teams built around him. John was the only 20-plus point per game scorer, carrying what would be mediocre teams to the playoffs on multiple occasions. Coming in 6th place, we have Trae Young. I'm well aware that as of this upload, Trae only spent 2 full seasons so far in the NBA, but he just came off a nearly 30 point per game season, and his upside is huge, making the All-Star team while nearly averaging a double-double with 9.3 assists and 29.6 points per game. If he has a long, healthy career going forward, he will definitely end up higher on this list one day. In 5th place, we have Dikembe Mutombo. Mutombo played 5 seasons in Atlanta, averaging over 13 points per game in his best season, but it's his all-time great defense that puts him on this list, making the All-Star teams twice and a 2-time Defensive Player of the Year while on the Hawks. He is probably one of the best Hawks defenders ever. Landing in 4th place, we have Lou Hudson. Super Lou spent most of his career with the Hawks, playing 11 seasons in a Hawks jersey and averaging over 22 points per game. He is a 6-time Hawks All-Star, All-NBA player, and All-Rookie. Coming in 3rd place, we have Cliff Hagan. Cliff is a Hall of Famer, NBA champ, is an All-Star and All-NBA player. He spent 10 seasons with the Hawks, averaging 18 points per game. In 2nd place, we have Bob Pettit. Bob is most certainly a legend, and you could argue he should get number 1, but we'll talk about that later. Bob is a Hawks lifer, Hall of Famer, Rookie of the Year, 2-time regular season MVP, 11-time All-Star, NBA champ, and 11-time All-NBA player, averaging over 26 points per game. Coming in 1st place is Dominique Wilkins. While Dominique is a legend, Bob's resume does look a tad bit better. But it's no question that Bob played in an era with only 8 teams for many seasons. And Wilkins played in the toughest NBA decades, being the 80s and 90s, scoring over 30 points per game in his highest season, and over 26 points per game overall while on the Hawks. He has been to many All-Star and All-NBA teams, won a scoring title, made the Hall of Fame. Now, of course, we all know that Hawks' Carmelo Anthony is truly the best Hawk. He is the only Hawk in a Hawks jersey to never miss a single shot, and is the only Hawk to never turn over the ball or foul anyone. But he is just too great to be put on this list. Next up, we take our talents to South Beach. The 10th best Heat player is Eddie Jones. Eddie spent 6 seasons in Miami, averaging 16 points per game. While Eddie got most of his accolades and All-Star appearances before joining the Heat, he still played at a near All-Star level while in Miami. In 9th place, we have Ronnie Cicely. Ronnie played 6 seasons in Miami, averaging over 15 points per game and over 17 points per game in his best season. He is the 1990 Most Improved Player, and while never got selected to an All-Star game, played at an All-Star level and helped lead his team to 2 playoff appearances. Coming in 8th place, we have Glenn Rice. Glenn played 6 seasons with the Heat, averaging over 19 points per game. While Glenn made his All-Star teams and All-NBA teams outside of Miami, he played near these levels with the Heat and helped them go to the playoffs twice. In 7th place, we have Jimmy Butler. While Jimmy only played one full season so far as of this upload with the Heat, you cannot deny his talents and his leadership that helped lead this Heat team all the way to the finals, where they had no business being that deep in the playoffs. He did make an all-star team with the Heat, and if he keeps things up, I could see him ending up higher on this list in the future. Landing in 6th place, we have Tim Hardaway. Tim is a two-time Heat all-star and all-NBA first player while wearing a Heat jersey. He spent 6 seasons in Miami, averaging over 17 points per game. He helped the Heat make the playoffs 6 times, and in his deepest run was to the Eastern Conference Finals, losing only to MJ. In 5th place, we have Chris Bosh. Many people will write Chris off as a third wheel, and while I won't pretend that he isn't better than LeBron or Wade, I think it's fair to say that there are no Heat championships without Bosh's all-star talent. It was Bosh's rebound that led to that legendary Ray Allen shot. Bosh is a 2-time Heat champ and a 6-time Heat All-Star, averaging 18 points per game in Miami. Coming in 4th place is Alonzo Mourning. Zo is a Hall of Famer, 4-time Heat All-Star, 2-time back-to-back Defensive Player of the Year, All-NBA player, and a 2-time All-Defensive player while wearing a Heat jersey. He even won a ring with him in 2006. I would have him higher if the competition going forward wasn't so tough, or if in 06 he was the main factor to the ring. He was definitely a factor for sure, but it was clear at the time that he was past his prime and played more of a veteran role in that finals. In 3rd place, we have Superman Shaquille O'Neal. Shaq only played 3.5 seasons in Miami, but he was still playing at a really high level when he was healthy. Sure, he was towards the end and probably exiting his prime, but he was still extremely dominant, averaging over 20 points per game and being a main factor for the Heat ring. Plus, he made an all-star team every season there. In 2nd place, and this is a tough call, but in 2nd place, we have LeBron James. Now, I will say that LeBron is the most talented player to ever wear a Heat jersey, but is he the greatest? LeBron spent just 4 seasons in Miami and did legendary things like win 2 MVPs, 2 Finals MVPs, and 2 rings. Yes, talent factors into greatness, but I don't think this is the end-all be-all, which brings us to 1st place. In 1st place, we have Dwayne Wade. Wade spent 15 seasons in Miami, and there's a reason why they call it Wade County in Southeast Florida. Wade is a 13-time All-Star, 3-time Heat champ, 8-time Heat All-NBA player, 3-time All-Defensive Player, All-Star MVP, All-Rookie Player, and a Finals MVP. While Wade doesn't have any regular season MVPs, he does have many MVP-caliber seasons, such as his 09 season, where he averaged 30 points per game, and his 06 season, where he won it all at the age of 24. There's a reason why LeBron came down to Miami. It's the same reason why Wade is number 1 on this list. Next up, we have the Hornets, and this covers the Charlotte Hornets and the Bobcats. The Pelicans and New Orleans Hornets will be in a different category. Coming in 10th place, we have the shortest player in NBA history, Muggsy Bogues. Muggsy spent 10 seasons with the Hornets, scoring more than 11 points per game in his best seasons. He helped the Hornets get to 3 playoffs, averaging 16 points per game in his highest playoff appearance in 1997. In 9th place, we have Emeka Okafor. Okafor had a pretty promising start to his career. He won Rookie of the Year with Charlotte, averaging over 15 points per game in his rookie season. He spent 5 seasons there, averaging 14 points per game. Landing in 8th place, we have Anthony Mason. Anthony only spent 3 seasons in Charlotte, but he did quite well, averaging over 16 points per game in his best season and almost 14 points per game overall. He made an All-NBA third team and All-Defensive second team while playing for this team. In 7th place, we have Alonzo Mourning. Alonzo spent his first 3 seasons in Charlotte, and these are his highest score seasons, averaging over 21 points per game. He made 2 All-Star teams, and if he stayed on this team longer, he would have easily ranked higher. Coming in 6th place, we have the lonely Bobcat All-Star Gerald Wallace. Wallace spent 7 seasons with the Bobcats, averaging over 16 points per game and over 19 points per game in his best season. He is the only All-Star to wear a Bobcats jersey and help the Bobcats make the playoffs once, which is an impressive feat in of itself. Not many players can carry the Bobcats to the playoffs. Ranking in 5th place is a player who played for both the Charlotte Hornets and New Orleans Hornets, and that's Baron Davis. Baron spent his first 3 seasons in Charlotte, averaging only 6 points per game in his rookie season, but quickly improved to over 18 points per game by his 3rd season. He even made the All-Star team in his 3rd season, and helped this team reach the playoffs all 3 times he was there. In 4th place, we have Glenn Rice. Glenn only played 3 seasons in Charlotte, but averaged a really impressive 23 points per game, and made the All-Star team 3 times for each season he was there. year. He also led this team to 2 playoff appearances. If he stayed on this team longer, he would have ranked higher. Coming in 3rd place, we have the father of Steph Curry, Del Curry. Del spent most of his career in Charlotte, playing 10 seasons, averaging 14 points per game overall, and over 16 points per game in his best season. He won 6th Man of the Year playing in Charlotte, and helped this team make the playoffs 4 times. While he never made an All-Star team, I do think he played at an All-Star level, and played an important role helping this team have playoff success. Ranking in 2nd place, we have Larry Johnson. Larry played his first 5 seasons in Charlotte, winning Rookie of the Year and averaging nearly 20 points per game. He is a 2-time Hornets All-Star who helped lead this team to the playoffs twice. He also made an All-NBA team in 1993. At 1st place, we have Kemba Walker. Kemba spent most of his career playing for both the Charlotte Bobcats and Hornets. He is a 3-time Charlotte All-Star, but played at an All-Star level for many more seasons. He led this team to 2 playoff appearances and made an All-NBA team. I have him at 1st because in his best season, he averaged over 25 points per game and was an extremely underrated point guard. Next up, we have the Utah Jazz. Ranking in 10th place, we have Jeff Hornacek. Jeff played his last 7 seasons with the Jazz, averaging roughly 15 points per game. And while he only made 1 All-Star team with the Suns, I do think he played near his All-Star level for many seasons with the Jazz, as he helped them go to the playoffs every season he was there. Ranking in 9th place, we have Andre Kirilenko. Andre is a Jazz All-Star who played most of his career in Utah at 10 seasons in total. He averaged over 12 points per game on the Jazz and over 16 points per game in his best scoring season. He is also a 3-time All-Defensive player and 2005 block champ. In 8th place, we have Carlos Boozer. Carlos spent 6 seasons with the Jazz, averaging almost 20 points per game and made 2 All-Star teams. He's an All-NBA player while playing with the Jazz and helped this team make the playoffs 4 times. Coming in 7th place, we have Rudy Gobert. Rudy will likely end up higher on this list if he continues to improve his game, but so far he's done many great things with the Jazz. He's a 3-time All-NBA player, 2-time Defensive Player of the Year, an All-Star, block champ, and 4-time All-Defensive player. In 6th place, we have Spider-Man, Donovan Mitchell. Much like Rudy, Donovan will likely end up much higher on this list, but he only played 3 seasons so far, yet has accomplished so much. He just got off averaging 24 points per game as an NBA All-Star, All-Rookie player, and helped his team make the playoffs 3 times so far, and I'm sure he's got many more to come. Landing in 5th place, we have Deron Williams. Deron played his first 6 seasons in Utah, averaging over 17 points per game. He's a 2-time Jazz All-Star, 2-time All-NBA player, and an All-Rookie player. He helped the Jazz go to 4 playoffs, and his furthest was all the way to the Western Conference Finals, where he fell short to the Spurs in 2007. In 4th place, we have the teacher, Adrian Dantley. Adrian is a Hall of Famer who spent 7 seasons with the Jazz, averaging roughly 30 points per game. He won 2 scoring titles with the Jazz, made 6 All-Star teams, and helped this team go to the playoffs twice. He would rank higher if there wasn't so much heavy competition going forward. Coming in 3rd place, we have Pistol Pete Maravich. Pistol Pete played 6 seasons with the Jazz, 5 of them being in New Orleans. He averaged over 25 points per game overall, and over 31 points per game in his best scoring season. Peter is a Hall of Famer, 3-time Jazz All-Star, and a Jazz scoring champion. I have Pete ahead of Adrian because while Adrian is the better scorer, he's a little more one-dimensional than Pete is. Pete led the Jazz in assists for 4 of the seasons while he was on the team. Adrian only led his team in scoring. In 2nd place, we have John Stockton. Stock is a Jazz lifer who spent 19 seasons in Utah. He currently has the most assists in NBA history with 15,806. He also has the most steals in the NBA with 3,265. He is a 10-time All-Star, 11-time All-NBA player, 9-time assist champ, 2-time steals champ, and 5-time All-Defensive player. The Stockton versus Malone debate is a close one, and their talents are apples to oranges, which is what makes this debate so hard. In 1st place, we have Karl Malone. Karl is an NBA Hall of Famer, 14-time All-Star, 2-time regular season MVP, 2-time All-Star MVP, 14-time All-NBA player, and 4-time All-Defensive player. Moving on, we have the Kings. Coming in 10th place, we have Vlade Divac. Vlade played 6 seasons with the Kings and averaged a little over 11 points per game, but almost 14 points per game in his best Kings season. He's a 1-time Kings All-Star. Landing in 9th place is Bobby Wagner. Bobby is a lifetime Royals player, which at the time was technically the Kings. He is a Hall of Famer who is a 5-time All-Star, 3-time All-NBA player, and 1951 champ. The Kings' only championship season. If Bobby had this success in a tougher era than the 40s and 50s, I would have ranked him higher. In 8th place, we have Boogie, DeMarcus Cousins, who is a 3-time Kings All-Star, All-Rookie, and All-NBA player. Cousins averaged over 21 points per game with the Kings and would have ranked higher if he got this team to the playoffs. Ranking in 7th place, we have Peja Stojakovic. Stojakovic is a 3-time Kings All-Star and Kings All-NBA player who averaged over 18 points per game during his 8 seasons in Sacramento. In his highest scoring season, he averaged over 24 points per game and led this team to 7 playoffs. In 6th place, we have Jerry Lucas, who played his first 7 seasons for the Cincinnati Royals, which are technically the Kings. He averaged almost 20 points per game with this team. Jerry is a Hall of Famer, 6-time Royals All-Star, All-NBA player, and Rookie of the Year. In 5th place comes Mitch Richmond. Mitch spent 7 seasons with the Kings, averaging over 23 points per game. Mitch is a Hall of Fame player who is a 6-time Kings All-Star, 5-time All-NBA player, an All-Star MVP, and he only led the Kings to 1 playoff berth. Had he gotten more, I would have ranked him higher. Coming in 4th place, we have Chris Webber. Chris played pretty much most of his prime with the Kings, spanning 7 seasons. He averaged over 23 points per game overall and over 27 points per game in his best scoring season. Webber is a 4-time Kings All-Star, Kings total rebound champ, made 5 All-NBA teams, and led his team to 6 playoff appearances as well. Landing in 3rd place, we have Nate Tiny Archibald. Nate spent his first 6 seasons with this team. He averaged over 25 points per game with the Kings and a massive 34 points per game in his highest scoring season. He's a 3-time Kings All-Star, scoring champion, All-NBA player, and in the Hall of Fame. In 2nd place, we have Jack Twyman. Jack is a Kings lifer, Hall of Fame player who made 6 All-Star teams and 2 All-NBA teams. In his highest scoring season, he averaged over 31 points per game. He helped lead the Kings to 6 playoff appearances. And in 1st place, we have the Big O, Oscar Robertson. Oscar played his first 10 seasons with the Royals, averaging 30 points per game. He won an MVP, Rookie of the Year, made 10 All-Star teams, All-NBA teams, won 3 All-Star MVPs, and led his team to 6 different playoff appearances. Next up, we go to the Big Apple with the New York Knicks. In 10th place, we have Amari Stoudemire. Amari played 5 seasons in New York, averaging over 17 points per game and over 25 points per game in his best Knicks season. He's a 1-time Knicks All-Star who helped this team go to the playoffs 3 times. Ranking in 9th place is Allen Houston. Houston spent most of his career in New York, playing 9 seasons with the Knicks. He averaged over 17 points per game and over 22 points per game in his best scoring season. He helped the Knicks go to the playoffs 5 times and made 2 All-Star teams while on the Knicks. In 8th place, we have Dave DeBuscher. Dave is a Knicks Hall of Fame player who played 6 seasons in New York. He averaged over 16 points per game and over 18 points per game in his best scoring season. Dave is a 5-time Knicks All-Star and 2-time Knicks champ who helped his team go to 6 playoffs. He's also an All-NBA player and 6-time All-Defensive player. Coming in 7th place, we have Earl Monroe. Earl is a Knicks Hall of Famer who played 9 seasons in New York, averaging over 16 points per game and over 20 points per game in his best scoring season. He's a 2-time Knicks All-Star and Knicks champ. You're probably wondering why I have him ahead of Dave. Well, Dave's resume is a little longer. If you break things down, you'll find out that Earl was a more efficient player. He scored roughly the same amount of points in much less time, playing 5 minutes less per game and having a higher field goal percentage by almost 7%, while also getting less fouls per game. You can also argue that Earl at his best was better than Dave at his best in terms of individual Knicks talent. Ranking in 6th place, we have Charles Oakley. Charles is a Knicks All-Star who spent 10 seasons in New York. While his stat sheet doesn't look too impressive, it was his all-time great defense that puts him on this list. He is a Knicks first and second all-defensive player. His defense helped the Knicks reach the playoffs all 10 seasons he was there. His deepest run was all the way to the finals against Hakeem and the Rockets. Coming in 5th place is Carmelo Anthony. Carmelo played 7 seasons in New York, averaging over 24 points per game and almost 29 points per game in his best scoring season. Melo was a 6-time Knicks All-Star, who led his team to 3 playoff appearances. He also made All-NBA teams and won a scoring title with the Knicks. Had Melo made it to more or even deeper playoff runs, he would have easily landed higher on this list. In 4th place, we have Bernard King. King only played 4 seasons with the Knicks, but did some monster things on this team. In his best season, he scored over 33 points per game, won a scoring title that year. He's a 2-time Knicks All-Star, All-NBA player who led New York to 2 playoffs and averaged 35 points per game in the 84 playoffs. Coming in 3rd place, we have Walt Frazier. Mr. Cool played his first 10 seasons with the Knicks, averaging almost 19 points per game and over 23 points per game in his highest scoring season. He's a 7-time All-Star, 7-time All-Defensive player, 6-time All-NBA player, and 2-time Knicks champ. In 2nd place, we have Willis Reed. speed. Willis is a Knicks lifer, 7-time All-Star, 2-time champ, 2-time Finals MVP, regular season MVP, Rookie of the Year, 5-time All-NBA, and an All-Defensive Player. He averaged over 21 points per game in his highest scoring season and roughly 19 points per game throughout his career. And in first place, we have Patrick Ewing. Now, Reed's resume is definitely better, and this is a really close call regardless. Reed dominated the 60s and 70s. Patrick Ewing dominated the 80s and 90s, which in my opinion is a far tougher era. With that in mind, Ewing is an 11-time Knicks All-Star, 6-time All-NBA, 3-time All-Defensive, Rookie of the Year, and Hall of Famer. In Patrick's best season, he played all 82 games and averaged almost 29 points per game in 1990, against some of the hardest NBA competition. Let me put it like this, if Willis and Patrick swapped places, I can totally see Patrick Ewing winning it all. And while Patrick doesn't have any MVPs, he did have plenty of MVP caliber seasons. Next up, we have one of the hardest teams to break down. The Lakers could use an entire video to themselves, but I will try my best to keep this bite-sized, yet packed with information. Coming in 10th place, we have Pau Gasol. Some close runner-ups include Byron Scott, Michael Cooper, and George Mikan. While George's resume and stats are far greater than Pau's, George dominated in the 50s with few teams, while Pau's success was in the modern NBA. Pau is a 3-time Lakers All-Star, 4-time All-NBA player, and 2-time champ. In 9th place, we have Anthony Davis. Now, if Anthony keeps up his game, I can actually see him ending up higher on this list, but for now, there are too many Laker greats for Anthony to dethrone them in just one season. However, Anthony is a Lakers All-Star, All-NBA player, All-Defensive player, and a Laker champion. Ranking in 8th place, we have Elgin Baylor. Mr. Inside is a Laker lifer who for one season averaged a video game 38 points per game. He is a Hall of Fame player, 11-time All-Star, 10-time All-NBA player, Rookie of the Year, and All-Star MVP. Coming in 7th place, we have the logo, Jerry West. Jerry is also a Laker lifer, Finals MVP, NBA champ, scoring champ, 14-time All-Star, assist champ, 12-time All-NBA player, 5-time All-Defensive player, and an All-Star MVP. If Jerry played for any other team, he could have easily been on the top two in those other lists. But in LA, there's just too many legends to go around. Landing in 6th place, we have Wilt Chamberlain. Now, I want to make it very clear that on an individual ranking, Wilt would easily be above a lot of these players going forward. Not all, but most of them. With that in mind, specifically on the Lakers, Wilt only played 5 seasons, averaging roughly 17 points per game. Now, he is a 4-time Lakers All-Star, a Lakers Finals MVP, and a Lakers champ, so he definitely has a lot to show for regarding his Laker-exclusive accolades. And of course, his on-court talent is to be factored in, but we also gotta consider he was a little past his prime during his Laker years. And of course, he retired as a Laker, averaging 13 points per game in his final season. In 5th place, we have the Sprite Cranberry King, LeBron James. LeBron so far has only played 2 full Laker seasons, but in just 2 full seasons, he already accomplished legendary things. He's been averaging roughly 27 points per game even while 35 years old, made 2 All-Star teams, 2 All-NBA teams, was the 2020 assist champion, averaging over 10 assists per game, and of course, he won a championship and Finals MVP. We also gotta factor in his on-court talent. Even in his older age, LeBron is playing at a GOAT status level. When LeBron retires, I am highly confident that he could easily end up higher on this list. In 4th place, we have Superman, Shaquille O'Neal. Shaq pretty much spent the majority of his prime in LA. In his 8 seasons, he averaged 27 points per game, won 3 rings, in a 3-peat, 3 Finals MVPs, a regular season MVP, and in his MVP season, averaged nearly 30 points per game, 3 blocks, and almost 14 rebounds. You could argue that LeBron is individually more talented than Shaq, but if you compare everything Shaq has put into LA compared to LeBron so far, I would give Shaq the Laker exclusive edge. In 3rd place, we have Magic Johnson. I don't need to list off Magic's accolades. What you want me to do is explain why I think he ranks lower than Kobe and Kareem. I will admit, if you just compare Laker awards, Magic has the best Lakers trophy case. But greatness is a combination of accolades, on-court talent, longevity, and success. In terms of talent, I think Kobe and Kareem are far better defenders than Magic is. All three have really close offensive skills, but Magic is the weakest defender compared to Kobe, who is a 12-time All-Defensive player, and Kareem, who is an 8-time All-Defensive Laker. All three are MVPs, champs, and finals MVPs. Magic also had the shortest career, and while you can argue that Magic accomplished more in less time, on the flip side, Kobe and Kareem proved that they can play at an elite level for much longer. Ranking in at second place, we have Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Let's cut to the chase. Why do I have Kareem above Magic, but below Kobe? If the game is all about winning, Kareem has more win shares than Magic, but less win shares than Kobe. Kareem proved that he can play longer at a higher level, and ultimately, I think Kareem at his best in his prime is better than Magic at his best in his prime. Kareem probably has the most on-court talent on this list, excluding maybe LeBron James, but when it comes to overall greatness, that's where number one comes in. Coming in first place, we have the Black Mamba, Kobe Bryant. Kobe Bryant is the ultimate definition of a team lifer and a Laker lifer. He has the NBA record for playing the most seasons with a single team. I don't need to list off Kobe's achievements, those are a given. You want to know why I have him above Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Kobe does have more Laker rings, but Kareem has more Laker regular season MVPs. No one has played more games as a Laker than Kobe. Minutes, field goals, points, steals, and win shares, all belonging to Kobe. Kobe is the most evolved Laker. He won Laker titles in two different eras with two drastically different teams. Kobe is Los Angeles. Rest in peace to the Mamba. We're leaving Disneyland and going to Disney World. Next up, we have the Orlando Magic. Coming in 10th place is Scott Skiles. Scott only spent 5 seasons in Orlando, but you can argue that he spent his entire prime with the Magic. In 1991, he won Most Improved Player, averaging over 17 points per game for the Magic in that season. Landing in 9th place, we have Vince Carter. Vince only played 2 seasons with the Magic, but did some magical things in such a short time. He averaged over 16 points per game in Orlando and helped this team reach the Eastern Conference Finals. In 8th place, we have Dennis Scott. Dennis played his first 7 seasons in Orlando, averaging almost 15 points per game overall and almost 20 points per game in his best scoring season. He's an all-rookie player who helped this team reach the playoffs 4 times. Ranking in 7th place, we have Nikola Vucevic. Nikola so far spent 8 seasons in Orlando, averaging over 17 points per game overall and recently roughly 20 points per game in his 2 most recent seasons. He's also an All-Star, making the All-Star team in 2019. He even helped this team reach 2 playoffs so far, and if he continues to improve, there will be many more playoffs to come and he could end up higher on this list for sure. In 6th place, we have Nick Anderson. Nick is a really underrated player. While he never made an All-Star team, he had multiple seasons where he averaged nearly 20 points per game, and he helped the Magic make 5 playoffs. He averaged over 20 points per game in his best playoff season. Coming in 5th place, we have Grant Hill. Grant Hill is a Hall of Fame player who spent 6 seasons in Orlando, averaging over 16 points per game. In his best Magic season, he averaged almost 20 points per game. He's a 2-time Magic All-Star who helped this team reach the playoffs in 2007. Landing in 4th place, we have Penny Hardaway. Now, if Penny was healthier, or if things worked out with him and Shaq winning it all, he could have ended up higher on this list. Penny is a 4-time Magic All-Star, 3-time All-NBA player, and averaged over 25 points per game in the finals, and over 21 points per game in his best Magic regular season. Coming in 3rd place, we have Tracy McGrady. Now this is a really, really close call between Dwight Howard and Tracy McGrady. And if you put Howard under McGrady, I can totally understand the pick. Tracy McGrady won both scoring titles in Orlando, averaging over 32 points per game with the Magic in 2003, which is quite legendary. He also won a Most Improved Player award while with the Magic. The main reason why I have Howard above McGrady is while they both led their teams to the playoffs, Howard went to much deeper runs. McGrady never got past the first round while on the Magic. In 2nd place, we have Dwight Howard. Howard led his Magic team all the way to the finals before, which only one other dominant center has ever done that for the Magic. But we'll talk about him in a bit. Howard is also a Defensive Player of the Year, Block Champ, All-Star, All-NBA Player, Rebound Champ, and an All-Rookie Player for Orlando. While McGrady is clearly clearly the better scorer, the gap between Howard's defense is way higher than the gap between McGrady's offense. Hopefully to no one's surprise, in first place we have Shaquille O'Neal. Shaq literally broke the NBA, not just figuratively, he literally destroyed NBA backboards while playing for the Magic. Shaq is one of the best centers to ever play NBA basketball, and while he only played 4 seasons with the Magic, he did some insane things there, like winning Rookie of the Year, becoming an All-Star, went all the way to the finals, and won a scoring title by scoring over 29 points per game, to name a few things he did while wearing a Magic's jersey. Next up, we have the Dallas Mavericks. In 10th place, we have Kristaps Porzingis. The main reason why the Unicorn ranks so low is based on his limited time so far in Dallas. If he stays healthy and continues to improve, he should end up much higher on this list in the future. In his one full season so far, he averaged over 20 points per game for the Mavericks. Landing in 9th place, we have Jason Terry. Jason spent 8 seasons in Dallas, averaging over 16 points per game. He won 6th Man of the Year in 2009, and of course won a ring in 2011. Jason is a really underrated player and one of the best players to ever make an All-Star team. In his best scoring season, he averaged almost 20 points per game. Coming in 8th place, we have Michael Finley. Finley played 9 seasons with the Mavericks, averaging roughly 20 points per game during that time. He helped lead the Mavericks to 5 playoffs and made 2 All-Star teams while playing in Dallas. In 7th place, we have Derek Harper. Harper spent 12 seasons in Dallas and averaged roughly 14.4 points per game throughout his time there. He averaged almost 20 points per game in his best Dallas seasons. While he never made an All-Star team, he definitely played at an All-Star level, both offensively and defensively, as he made 2 All-Defensive teams. He also helped the Mavericks make the playoffs 6 times. Ranking in 6th place, we have Rolando Blackman. Rolando spent most of his career with the Mavericks, his first 11 seasons. He is a 4-time All-Star who averaged over 19 points per game and over 22 points per game in his highest scoring regular season. In the 1985 playoffs, he averaged over 32 points per game and helped Dallas get to the playoffs 6 times total. Coming in 5th place, we have Steve Nash. Now, Steve was drafted by the Suns, played 2 seasons there, got traded to Dallas, spent 6 seasons there, and went back to Phoenix to play 8 seasons. So the Mavericks' Nash is a Nash that was about to enter his prime. Not necessarily the MVP Nash, but one that was coming there. He is a 2-time Dallas All-Star, and in his best Mavericks season, he averaged almost 18 points per game, and his highest assist total was 8.8 per game. He would be much higher on the list if the Mavericks had pure prime MVP Nash. In 4th place, we have Jason Kidd. Now, Kidd has somewhat of an opposite story of Nash. He played his first 2.5 seasons in Dallas, got traded to Phoenix, then later in his career came back to ultimately win the chip in 2011. He made an All-Star team in both Dallas runs, once in 1996 in his first Dallas stint, and then in 2010 during his return to Dallas. In his highest scoring Dallas season, he averaged almost 17 points per game, he was Rookie of the Year for the Mavericks, and of course, won the chip with them, which is why he has the slight edge above Mavericks exclusive Steve Nash. Landing in 3rd place, we have Luka Doncic. I understand Luka is just entering his 3rd season, but I really think he is about to tear this league with his on-court talent, and that's something we can't write off. He won Rookie of the Year, and in his 2nd season, became an All-Star averaging over 28 points per game, and almost 9 assists per game. He made an All-NBA first team, and lifted the Mavericks to the playoffs in just his 2nd season, averaging over 31 points per game in the playoffs. It is entirely possible that he could end up higher on this list in the future. In 2nd place, we have Mark Aguirre. Mark played his first 8 seasons in Dallas and made an All-Star team 3 times there, but played at an All-Star level for much more. In his best scoring season, he averaged almost 30 points per game and averaged almost 25 points per game during his time there. Mark led his team to 5 playoff appearances, and his deepest run was to the Western Finals, ultimately losing to the Lakers. It is possible that Luka could take this spot, but I would like to see Luka at least get to the Western Finals or higher before he could claim this spot. And in 1st place, to hopefully no one's surprise, we have Dirk Nowitzki. This one needs no explanation. Dirk is an MVP and an NBA champion. What more needs to be said about this absolute legend? Moving on, we have the Nets, and before we start, I do need to say that Kevin Durant would easily make this list if he returns to form, or at least close to his pre-injury shape. But as of this video's upload, he hasn't played a full Nets season yet, so I don't think it is completely fair to put him on this list. With that being said, in 10th place, we have Kerry Kittles. Carey spent most of his career with the Nets, playing 7 out of 8 seasons there. He averaged over 14 points per game and over 17 points per game in his best Nets season. He's an all-rookie player who helped his team make the playoffs 4 times. Coming in 9th place, we have Richard Jefferson. While Richard never made an all-star team, he has many all-star level seasons for both his defense and offense. He spent 7 seasons with the Nets, averaging over 17 points per game and over 22 points per game in his best scoring season. He helped the Nets reach the finals before in 2003. Coming in 8th place, we have Rick Barry. Now, I need to make it clear that Rick only played with the Nets while he was part of the ABA, but Rick also has elite NBA talent and eventually played in the NBA. I understand if some people wouldn't want to include ABA accolades, which is fair, but Rick is a huge part of Nets history, and his talent is worthy of being recognized as he averaged over 31 points per game with the ABA Nets, and was named to the ABA first team in all 4 seasons he played in the league, and 5 times when he eventually entered the NBA. In 7th place, we have Drazen Petrovic. Drazen only played 3 seasons with the Nets, but had some great success. He made it to the Hall of Fame, made the 1993 All-NBA team, averaged over 22 points per game in his best Nets season. He helped the Nets reach the playoffs for 2 seasons, and I do have him ahead of Rick Barry because I do think it is fair to give weight to a 90s NBA achievement over 70s ABA achievements. In 6th place, we have Brook Lopez. Brook played 9 seasons with the Nets and averaged over 18 points per game while there, and he averaged over 20 points per game in his best scoring season. He is a Nets All-Star and All-Rookie player who helped this team reach the playoffs 2 times, averaging over 22 points per game in his best playoff run. In 5th place, we have Kyrie Irving. Now, so far as of this upload, Kyrie has only played 20 games for the Nets, but there is no denying his on-court talent and what he can bring to the Nets franchise. In some aspect, this can be said also for Kevin Durant, but I can't include KD just yet until we see him on the court. Kyrie averaged an insane 27.4 points per game and is one of the best ball handlers this franchise has ever seen. He and KD could end up being higher on this list in the future. Coming in 4th place is Vince Carter. Vince only played 5 seasons with the Nets, but you can argue he spent a big chunk of his prime there. He made 3 All-Star teams with the Nets and averaged over 23 points per game and over 27 points per game in his best scoring regular season on that team. He led the Nets to 3 playoff appearances, his deepest Nets run being the Eastern Semifinals. In 3rd place, we have Buck Williams. Buck played his first 8 seasons with the Nets, averaging over 16 points per game and over 18 points per game in his best scoring season. He won Rookie of the Year, made an All-NBA team, All-Defensive team, and 3 All-Star teams. He led the Nets to 5 playoff appearances, his deepest run being the second round. In 2nd place is Jason Kidd. Jason played 7 seasons with the Nets, and arguably the majority of his prime was with this team. He averaged over 14 points per game while there, and over 18 points per game in his best Nets scoring season. He made 5 All-Star teams with the Nets and led this team to the finals in 2003. In 1st place, we have Dr. J, Julius Irving. While Julius won 3 straight ABA MVP awards and led the Nets to 2 ABA championships, again, it is a little difficult to give ABA accolades the same way as NBA accolades, but Dr. J himself proved his mettle by dominating the NBA as well. There is no denying that he is a part of Nets history and his on-court talent is unmatched. To only make maybe Kevin Durant, who still hasn't played a full season yet as of this upload. Next up, we have the Denver Nuggets, and coming in 10th place is Marcus Camby. Marcus played 6 seasons in Denver, and while he only averaged 10 points per game, it was his defense that gets him onto this list. He won Defensive Player of the Year in 2007, won 3 block titles in Denver, and made 4 all-defensive teams while on the Nuggets. Landing in 9th place is Jamal Murray. Jamal has only completed 4 full seasons so far, but he has a lot of upside, and if he continues to improve, he could one day easily end up higher on this list. He made the All-Rookie team, and while he hasn't made an All-Star team yet, he certainly has been playing like one last season, averaging nearly 19 points per game, and helped this team reach the conference finals, beating the Clippers in the second round. In 8th place, we have Fat Lever. Fat was putting up some really heavy numbers, no pun intended, scoring almost 20 points per game for for many seasons on the Nuggets. He made two All-Star teams, an All-NBA team, and an All-Defensive team in 1998. He helped the Nuggets reach six playoff appearances. Ranking in seventh place, we have the answer, Allen Iverson. Iverson only played two full seasons and technically three seasons with the Nuggets. Had he spent more time here, he would have ranked higher on the list. But he did put up some monster numbers, averaging over 25 points per game and over 26 points per game in his highest Nuggets season. He is a two-time Nuggets All-Star and helped the Nuggets reach the playoffs twice. Coming in sixth place is Chauncey Billups. Chauncey played five seasons in Denver, two early in his career and then three later in his career as a veteran mentor to Carmelo. Overall, he put up nearly 17 points per game and over 19 points per game in his highest Nuggets scoring regular season. He helped the Nuggets reach the playoffs twice and made two All-Star teams while in Denver. In fifth place, we have Nikola Jokic. Jokic may very well end up higher on this list one day, but coming in the top 5 at just age 24 is still extremely impressive. So far, he's a two-time All-Star, two-time All-NBA player, All-Rookie player, and in his most recent season, averaged nearly 20 points per game. He's got a lot of upside going forward and is one of the best active centers in the modern NBA. Ranking in fourth place is Dikembe Mutombo. Dikembe played his first five seasons in Denver, and in his highest scoring Denver season, he put up nearly 17 points per game. He's a three-time Nuggets All-Star, one-time Nuggets Defensive Player of the Year, and three-time Nuggets Block Champ, as he insanely averaged over four blocks per game in multiple seasons in Denver. In third place, we have Dan Issel. Dan is a Hall of Fame center and was way ahead of his time. He was an undersized center at 6'9", who had the ability to space the floor and hit mid-rangers in an era where most centers relied on size and physical dominance. He is a seven-time All-Star and averaged over 20 points per game on the Nuggets. He helped the Nuggets make the playoffs seven times. Coming in second place, and this is close, but we have Carmelo Anthony. If Melo spent more of his career or more of his prime in Denver, he could have took that number one spot. But we'll get to number one in a bit. Carmelo is a four-time Nuggets All-Star who put up nearly 25 points per game with the Nuggets and almost 29 points per game in his best Nuggets scoring season. He helped his team reach the playoffs seven times, and his deepest run was the Western Conference Finals. In first place, we have Alex English. Alex is a Hall of Fame player who played 11 seasons with the Nuggets. He averaged over 25 points per game and over 28 points per game in his highest Nuggets regular season. He made the All-Star team eight times in Denver, three All-NBA teams, and won himself a scoring title in 1983. His deepest playoff run was also to the Western Finals, where he lost to the Lakers. How history repeats itself, because that's how Melo's deepest playoff run also went. Next up, we have the Pacers, and in 10th place is Roy Hibbert. Roy played his first seven seasons with Indiana, averaging over 11 points per game. He is a two-time Pacers All-Star and All-Defensive player. While he isn't much of a scorer, it was his defense that puts him on this list, averaging over two blocks per game for many seasons. Landing in 9th place is Domantas Sabonis. Sabonis is still very young and could easily end up higher on this list in the future. He's so far made one All-Star team with the Pacers, averaging over 18 points per game in the 2020 season. He helped the Pacers make the playoffs twice so far when many people counted this team out. In 8th place, we have Danny Granger. Danny, for a time, had flashes of greatness, where if he had stayed healthy and kept his game up, he could have been much more and much higher on this list. He was the 2009 Most Improved Player, a Pacers All-Star, and an All-Rookie player. His highest scoring seasons are around 26 points per game, and he helped his team make the playoffs three times. His deepest run was taking LeBron and the Heat to six games in the second round. Coming in 7th place is Victor Oladipo. If Oladipo gets healthy and returns to shape, he could end up higher on this list in the future for sure. So far, he's a two-time Pacers All-Star who averaged over 23 points per game in his best scoring season. He is also an All-NBA player, All-Defensive player, steals champ, and helped his team make the playoffs twice when no one outside of Pacers fans expected it. In 6th place, we have Rick Smits. The dunking Dutchman is a Pacers lifer, All-Star, All-Rookie player. In his best scoring season, he put up over 18 points per game and averaged nearly 15 points per game throughout his career. The 7'4 center helped this team make the playoffs 10 times. His deepest playoff run was making it all the way to the finals in 2000. He made it to the Eastern Finals in 1995, averaging 20 points per game in the playoffs that season. Ranking in 5th place is Dale Davis. Double D is a Pacers All-Star who was pretty much a walking double-double, averaging roughly 10 points and 10 rebounds for many seasons with the Pacers. He helped the Pacers make the playoffs 8 times, and this is a close call between Rick and Dale for this spot. I have Dale slightly above Rick because he was more athletic, was slightly more efficient, and had more win shares. In 4th place, we have Mark Jackson. Mark only made one All-Star team with the Knicks, but he played near that All-Star level for many seasons, and while on the Pacers, he won an assist champion in 1997, playing the second half of that season in Indiana, averaging over 11 assists per game in that season. He helped the Pacers make the playoffs 5 times, his deepest run being the finals against the Lakers in 2000. Mark was the starting point guard for this team, and his ability to run the team clearly shows that his success was a contributing factor to helping that team reach the finals. In 3rd place, we have the O'Neal that many forget about, and that's Jermaine O'Neal. And no, Shaq and Jermaine aren't related, but they are both really talented players. Jermaine spent pretty much his entire prime with the Pacers. He played in Indiana for 8 seasons, averaging over 18 points per game and over 24 points per game in his best scoring season. He is a 6-time Pacers All-Star, 3-time Pacers All-NBA player, and 2002 Most Improved Player, who led his team to 6 playoff appearances. The second best Pacer ever so far is Paul George. Paul is a 4-time Pacers All-Star, 3-time All-NBA Pacer, 3-time All-Defensive Pacer, Most Improved Player, and averaged nearly 24 points per game in his best scoring seasons with the Pacers. He took the Pacers to the playoffs 6 out of 7 seasons there, and he had back-to-back Eastern Conference Finals appearances, losing to LeBron in both runs. I have Paul ahead of Jermaine because I think Paul is the better two-way player. They are close offensively, but Paul is easily the better defender. Hopefully to no one's surprise, in 1st place, we have Reggie Miller. Why this Hall of Fame Pacer lifer ranks number 1 needs no explanation. Moving on, we have the Pelicans, and I am counting all New Orleans players. At 10th place, anything is possible because we have J.R. Smith. J.R. Swish played his first 2 seasons with the Hornets and was able to put up some solid numbers, roughly 10 points per game, and shot 37% from 3 in his second season, which was really good. He's also a solid defender. In 9th place, we have Tyson Chandler. Tyson only played 3 seasons with the Hornets, over 11 rebounds per game and over 10 points per game. The walking double-double also helped his team make the playoffs twice, his deepest Hornets run being the second round. In 8th place is Peja Stojakovic. Peja played 5 seasons with the Hornets, averaging over 14 points per game and over 17 points per game in his best Hornets season. He helped his team reach the playoffs twice, and while he was a 3-time Kings All-Star, he played near an All-Star level for many seasons in New Orleans. Ranking in 7th place is Zion Williamson. Even with just 1 season under his belt, Zion is certainly good enough to be on this list, and will likely end up higher on this list in the near future. He averaged over 22 points per game in his rookie season, made an all-rookie team, and has a player efficiency rating of 24.1, which for a rookie is amazing. He has huge upside going forward for sure. Coming in 6th place is Baron Davis. Now to make it clear, Davis played 3 seasons with the Charlotte Hornets and 3 seasons with the New Orleans Hornets, but technically played for 2 different franchises in each of these runs. In his 3 seasons in New Orleans, he averaged over 20 points per game, was a steals champ, averaging 2.4 steals per game in 2004, and he helped his team reach the playoffs twice. He is also a 1-time Hornets All-Star and All-NBA player. In 5th place is DeMarcus Cousins. Boogie played about 1.5 seasons with the Pelicans, and if he was healthier, he could have done much more and ranked higher. He averaged 25 points per game during his time in New Orleans and was selected to 1 All-Star game, but didn't play due to injury. In 4th place, we have Drew Holiday. Drew was a Philly All-Star, but had much better seasons with the Pelicans, averaging over 17 points per game in 7 seasons in New Orleans. He is a 2-time All-Defensive Pelican, and helped this team reach the playoffs twice. In 3rd place is David West. West is a 2-time Hornets All-Star who averaged over 16 points per game in New Orleans, playing a total of 8 seasons there. He averaged over 21 points per game in his best Hornets season, and helped this team get to the playoffs 3 times. Who gets 2nd is a really close call between Anthony Davis and Chris Paul. Keep in mind, we're only factoring their New Orleans appearances. Coming in 2nd place is Anthony Davis. I'll go over why Chris lands 1st in a bit. And these two are apples to oranges anyway. If you disagree with this pick, I totally understand. Anthony is a 6-time Hornets All-Star, 3-time block champ, multiple All-NBA and All-Defensive player, and an All-Rookie player who averaged over 23 points per game during his time with the Hornets. Now, he only led this team to just 2 playoff appearances and got swept in one of them, which is why I have him slightly lower than Chris Paul. But again, this is not counting his Laker achievements. In 1st place, we have Chris Paul. Paul spent his first 6 seasons with the Hornets, averaging almost almost 19 points per game and 10 assists per game. In his best season, he averaged almost 23 points per game and over 11 assists per game and almost 3 steals per game. He is a 3-time steals champ for the Hornets and 2-time assist champ. He is a 4-time Hornets All-Star who took this team to the playoffs 3 times. He made 3 All-NBA teams, 3 All-Defensive teams, won Rookie of the Year while playing for the Hornets, and I have Paul ahead of Anthony for the Hornets specifically because I think he accomplished more in less time, and leading the league in both assists and steals for multiple seasons is very impressive. Paul is not only a great scorer, but also a great floor general, and most impressively, a great defender. Anthony Davis is also a great defender, but most point guards are kind of mediocre defenders, so for Paul to be great on both ends of the floor and have better playoff success is why I have him slightly ahead of Anthony Davis. Moving on, we have the Pistons. In 10th place is Allen Iverson. AI only played one season in Detroit. Had he played longer or played during his prime, he would have easily ranked higher. His one season, even at 33 years old, he put up over 17 points per game and made an all-star team. In 9th place, we have Andre Drummond. Andre spent his first 8 seasons in Detroit, averaging 14.5 points per game and almost 14 rebounds per game. He is a 2-time all-star and 4-time total rebounding champion. In his best rebounding season, he averaged an insane 16 rebounds per game. He helped get this team to 2 playoff appearances, but they were both first-round exits. If he had more playoff success, he would have ranked higher on this list. In 8th place is Richard Hamilton. Rip Hamilton is a 3-time Pistons All-Star and 2004 champ who averaged over 18 points per game in his 9 seasons with Detroit. In 2006, he led the league in 3-point percentage from 46% from 3. He helped the Pistons make the playoffs 7 times and averaged over 20 points per game in the postseason. In his championship season, he averaged over 21 points per game in the playoffs, proving he was a contributing factor to that ring. In 7th place ranks Dennis Rodman. Rodman is a 2-time Pistons All-Star, 2-time champ, and 2-time total rebounding champ for the Pistons, averaging a legendary 18 rebounds per game in those 2 seasons. His defense is also one of the best Detroit has ever seen. He is a 2-time Defensive Player of the Year for the Pistons, who made 5 All-Defensive teams in Detroit. His defense helped this team get to 6 playoffs and win 2 rings in Detroit. Ranking at 6th place is Bob Lanier. Bob is a Hall of Fame player who played in Detroit for 10 seasons, making the All-Star team 7 times there. He averaged over 22 points per game and over 25 points per game in his best scoring season. He led this team to 4 playoff appearances and averaged 28 points per game in his highest scoring postseason on 63% shooting. In 5th place, we have Big Ben, Ben Wallace. While Ben isn't much of a scorer, it's his all-time great defense which puts him on this list. He is a 4-time Pistons All-Star, 4-time Defensive Player of the Year, 2004 NBA champ, All-Defensive, 2-time rebounding champ, and a block champ. In his best rebounding season, he averaged over 15 rebounds per game and 3.5 blocks per game in 2002. Coming in 4th place is Chauncey Billups. Mr. Big Shot is an NBA champ, a Finals MVP. He's also a 4-time Pistons All-Star, All-NBA, and All-Defensive player. He played 8 seasons in Detroit, averaging over 16 points per game and almost 19 points per game in his best scoring season. In the finals, he led the league to beat the Lakers, averaging over 21 points per game. Ranking in at 3rd place is Bill Laimbeer. Bill is a 4-time Pistons All-Star, 2-time Pistons champ, and total rebounding champ, averaging over 13 rebounds per game. This is really close between Bill and Chauncey. I have Laimbeer slightly ahead of Chauncey since he spent much more time in Detroit playing 13 seasons there. His best scoring seasons, he averaged over 17 points per game multiple times and was a walking double-double for most of his career. In 2nd place is Joe Dumars. Joe is a Detroit lifer, NBA Hall of Fame player, 6-time All-Star, 2-time champ, Finals MVP, 3-time All-NBA, 5-time All-Defensive, and All-Rookie player who averaged over 23 points per game in his best scoring season and over 16 points per game overall. And in 1st place, hopefully to no one's surprise, is Isaiah Thomas. This one needs no explanation. Thomas is one of the greatest point guards ever. Next up, we are going north with the Raptors. Coming in 10th place is Tracy McGrady. Now, if this was prime McGrady, he would be much, much higher on this list. Tracy only played his first 3 seasons in Toronto, and while his first 2 seasons were pretty mediocre, his 3rd season is where he really started to improve, scoring over 15 points per game. He also helped the Raptors reach the playoffs once. ranking in 9th place is Fred VanVleet. So far, Fred has completed 4 full seasons with the Raptors. In his latest season, he put up nearly 18 points per game, is also a 2019 NBA champ. Fred has a lot of upside who could very likely end up higher on this list in the future. In 8th place, we have Damon Stoudemire. While Damon only played 3 seasons in Toronto, he accomplished some pretty great things. He won Rookie of the Year and averaged nearly 20 points per game. This is a close call between Fred and Damon, but Damon was scoring out of the get-go, whereas Fred needed a few seasons to develop to the player he is now. Though in the future, Fred could easily pass up Damon. Coming in at 7th place is Antonio Davis. Davis spent 6 seasons with the Raptors, and the majority of his prime was in Toronto. He made an all-star team, averaged almost 13 points per game and almost 15 points per game in his best scoring season. He helped this team reach the playoffs 3 times and averaged 17 points per game in his highest scoring playoff run and over 16 points per game in his deepest playoff run, making it to the second round. In 6th place ranks DeMar DeRozan. DeMar played his first 9 seasons in Toronto, averaging nearly 20 points per game and 27 points per game in his highest scoring season. He is a 4-time Raptors All-Star and All-NBA player who helped his team reach the playoffs 5 times. His deepest run was all the way to the Eastern Finals, where LeBron made the dinosaurs go extinct. Coming in 5th place is Pascal Siakam. Siakam only played 4 full seasons in Toronto so far, but has a ton of upside and two-way on-court talent. He is the 2019 Most Improved Player, a 2019 NBA champ, All-NBA player, and an All-Star. He averaged nearly 23 points per game in 2020. I have Siakam slightly ahead of DeRozan due to that championship ring, and he's got a lot of upside going forward. Landing in 4th place is Chris Bosh. Boshosaurus is a 5-time Raptors All-Star, All-NBA player, and All-Rookie player who averaged over 20 points per game with the Raptors. In his best scoring season, he averaged 24 points per game and led this team to 2 playoff appearances, averaging 24 points per game in his second playoff run. In 3rd place is Kyle Lowry. Kyle is a 6-time Raptors All-Star, 2019 NBA champ, All-NBA player who averaged over 17 points per game on the Raptors, and in his best scoring season put up over 22 points per game. He helped his team reach the playoffs 7 times so far, and is an NBA champ. It's time someone called Air Canada, because in 2nd place we have the flying man, Vince Carter. Vince spent his first 7 seasons with the Raptors, winning Rookie of the Year, became an All-NBA player, making 6 All-Star appearances. He averaged over 23 points per game, and over 27 points per game in his best scoring season. He led his team to 2 playoff appearances, and in his second playoff run, he averaged over 27 points per game, making it to the second round. Ranking in 1st place, we have the Claw, Kawhi Leonard. Kawhi only played just 1 season in Toronto, but pulled some legendary things. He won a ring, Finals MVP, made an All-Star team, All-NBA team, All-Defensive team, and averaged nearly 27 points per game in Canada. The best argument being against Leonard at being at number 1 would be his such short time, but when you're the only franchise's Finals MVP ever, it's hard to beat. Houston, we have a problem, but we also have 10 solutions, and coming in 10th place for the Rockets is Charles Barkley. Charles played his last 4 seasons with the Rockets and pretty much had the bitter end of his prime, but still was a great overall player. If the Rockets had peak Charles, he would easily be much higher on this list. Charles averaged roughly 16 points per game in Houston, made 1 All-Star team in his first season there. Coming in 9th place is Chris Paul. This is a really close call between Charles Barkley and Chris Paul. I could see this going either way, and while Chris only played 2 seasons in Houston, I think Paul was closer to his prime in Houston over Chuck was. Paul averaged almost 19 points per game and 8 assists in his first season, and during the postseason, he made it all the way to the Western Conference Finals and was 1 leg injury away from beating one of the greatest teams in history, being the Golden State Warriors. Landing in 8th place, we have Russell Westbrook. While Russell only played 1 season with the Rockets, he was certainly still in his prime during that time and put up great numbers pretty close to his MVP season. He averaged over 27 points per game, nearly 8 rebounds per game, and 7 assists per game. He also made the All-Star team and an All-NBA team. In 7th place comes Calvin Murphy. Calvin is a Rockets lifer who played all 13 seasons with the Rockets, including 1 season with the San Diego Rockets. While I do think Russell, Chris Paul, and Charles are individually more talented than Calvin, guys like Russ only played 57 games in a Rockets jersey. Calvin spent 13 total seasons, made an All-Star team, made it to the finals, and averaged over 25 points per game in his highest scoring season, and nearly 18 points per game throughout his career. In 6th place, we have Ralph Sampson. Ralph spent his first 5 seasons season in Houston, and if he didn't run into injury troubles later into his career, he could have been much higher on this list. During his time with the Rockets, he was a four-time All-Star, All-NBA player, and Rookie of the Year, who averaged roughly 20 points per game and 10 rebounds per game. He helped the Rockets get to 3 playoff appearances and 1 finals appearance. Coming in 5th place is Yao Ming. Yao is an 8-time Rockets All-Star, who made the All-Star team every season he played. He's a Hall of Fame player who averaged roughly 20 points per game throughout his career, made 5 All-NBA teams, an All-Rookie team, and helped his team get to 4 playoff appearances. Landing in 4th place is Tracy McGrady. Tracy spent his longest in a Rockets jersey, playing 6 total seasons, and was in the bulk of his prime in Houston. He made an All-Star team 3 times in Houston, and scored over 22 points per game as average, and over 25 points per game in his best Rockets scoring regular season. He helped the Rockets reach the playoffs 3 times, and scored over 27 points per game in his highest Rockets postseason. I have Tracy slightly above Yao, because I think Tracy was the driving offensive force of that team when they played together, which helped Yao reach new heights. In 3rd place is James Harden. James played 8 full seasons with the Rockets, has 3 scoring titles in Houston, averaged nearly 30 points per game during his time there, and over 36 points per game in his highest scoring season. He is an 8-time All-Star, an assist champ, 7-time All-NBA player, and of course an MVP. If the next 2 spots didn't have absolute legends, James would have ranked much higher. Coming in 2nd place is Moses Malone. Moses is a 2-time Rockets MVP who played 6 seasons in Houston. He is also a 5-time Houston All-Star who averaged over 31 points per game in his highest Rockets scoring season. He took the Rockets to the finals before, and so far has twice as many MVPs as James Harden, at least in terms of Rockets-only accolades. This is why I have him ranked ahead of James. Hopefully to no one's surprise, coming in 1st place is Hakeem Olajuwon. Hakeem the Dream played pretty much his entire career with the Rockets, save for his last season with the Raptors. He is a 12-time All-Star, MVP, 2-time Defensive Player of the Year, 12-time All-NBA player, 2-time champ, 9-time All-Defensive, 2-time Finals MVP, and averaged over 22 points per game during his time as a Rocket. While you might have an argument for Moses being the overall better player, and that debate in of itself is up in the air, there is no denying that if you only count Rockets' exclusive accolades, Hakeem takes the spot no question. Moving on, we have the Spurs, and in 10th place is DeMar DeRozan. DeMar spent his most 2 recent seasons in San Antonio, averaging over 21 points per game, and made the playoffs once in 2019. He didn't make an All-Star team in those 2 years, but did play at an All-Star level. Landing in 9th place is LaMarcus Aldridge. LaMarcus played 5 seasons so far with the Spurs, averaging nearly 20 points per game, made 2 All-Star teams, and helped the Spurs get to 4 playoffs. Coming in 8th place is James Silas. James spent his entire career with the Spurs, save for his final season in Cleveland. He played with the Spurs in both his ABA and NBA days. In his best NBA scoring season, he averaged almost 18 points per game, is a 2-time ABA All-Star, and helped the Spurs make the NBA playoffs 4 times. Ranking in 7th place is Sean Elliott. Elliott spent most of his career with the Spurs, played 11 seasons in San Antonio. He is a 2-time Spurs All-Star, All-Rookie player, an NBA champ, averaged over 14 points per game throughout his career and 20 points per game in his best scoring season. He helped the Spurs make the playoffs 9 times and was a contributing factor in their title run, averaging almost 12 points per game in that postseason. Coming in 6th place is George Gervin. George is a Hall of Fame player who spent most of his career with the Spurs, a total of 12 seasons, that's 3 ABA seasons and 9 NBA seasons. He is a 9-time NBA All-Star, 7-time All-NBA player, and most impressively, 4-time NBA scoring champ. For many seasons, he put up over 30 points per game, and in his highest scoring season, he put up over 33 points per game. He helped his team make the playoffs 8 times, but never won a title. In 5th place, we have Manu Ginobili. This is a really close call between Gervin and Ginobili. If you just glance over their stats, it's easy to say that George was the better scorer, but Ginobili did what's best for his team and took a smaller role. If Ginobili was the first scoring option and was told to score first, his 20 point per game season is proof that he has the ability to put up good scoring numbers. Ginobili is a 2-time All-Star, 2-time All-NBA player, 6th Man of the Year, and 4-time NBA champ. In 4th place is Kawhi Leonard. Kawhi Leonard played his first 7 seasons with the Spurs and had a monster 2017 season where he averaged over 25 points per game. He is a Spurs champ and Finals MVP, a 2015 Steals champ, All-NBA, All-Defensive Player, and 2-time Defensive Player of the Year. If ranking in 2nd place is David Robinson. The Admiral played his entire career with the Spurs, and if the next guy on this list wasn't the greatest power forward ever, he could have ranked number 1. Robinson is a Hall of Famer, 10-time All-Star, scoring champ, block champ, 2-time NBA champ, 10 10-time All-NBA player, regular season MVP, defensive player of the year, 8-time All-Defensive player, and averaged nearly 30 points per game in his best scoring season. In first place is Tim Duncan. The big fundamental is a Spur lifer, Hall of Fame player, 5-time champ, 15-time All-Star, 15-time All-NBA player, 15-time All-Defensive player, 2-time regular season MVP, 3-time Finals MVP, Rookie of the Year, and averaged over 25 points per game in his best scoring season. Next up, we have the Phoenix Suns. In 10th place is Larry Nance Sr. Larry is a Suns All-Star who in his best season scored over 20 points per game and averaged nearly 17 points per game throughout his entire time with the Suns. He is a slam dunk champ who helped his team get to 3 playoff rounds. His deepest run was to the Western Finals, where he averaged nearly 17 points per game in that postseason. Coming in 9th place is Jason Kidd. Jason spent 5 seasons with the Suns, averaging almost 15 points per game and 10 assists per game. He won 3 assist champions with the Suns, a 3-time Suns All-Star who helped the team get to the playoffs 5 times. Ranking in 8th place is Devin Booker. If Devin continues to improve his game and stays on the Suns long term, he will definitely end up higher on this list one day. Devin is an All-Star who in his latest season scored over 26 points per game and has a ton of upside going forward. He has averaged over 22 points per game throughout his career and over 25 points per game in his last 3 seasons. In 7th place is Sean Marion. Sean played his first 9 seasons with the Suns, averaging over 18 points per game. He is a 4-time Suns All-Star and All-NBA player who averaged over 21 points per game in his highest scoring season. He helped his team reach the playoffs 6 times, his deepest Suns run being the Western Finals. Landing in 6th place is Connie Hawkins. Hawkins is a 4-time Suns All-Star who averaged over 20 points per game with the Suns. He is a Hall of Fame player, but only got to 1 Suns postseason. Had he had more playoff success, he would have ranked higher. In 5th place, we have Paul Westphal. Paul is a 4-time Suns All-Star, All-NBA player, and averaged over 20 points per game while on the Suns. He scored over 25 points per game in his highest scoring season and led the Suns to 4 playoff appearances, his deepest run being the Finals in 1976, where he lost to his former team, the Celtics. Ranking in 4th place is Amari Stoudemire. Stoudemire played his first 8 seasons with the Suns, winning Rookie of the Year, made 5 All-Star teams, made 4 All-NBA teams, averaged over 25 points per game, his highest scoring Suns season, and over 21 points per game overall. He helped his team reach the playoffs 5 times, his deepest run being the Western Finals. In 3rd place, we have Kevin Johnson. Now, of course, when you're playing on a team that has Charles Barkley, it's hard to get all the spotlight onto you, but Kevin Johnson was the head of this Suns team for a few seasons before he and Barkley teamed up. He is a 3-time Suns All-Star and 5-time All-NBA player who averaged over 22 points per game in his best scoring season. He is also a walking double-double, as he averaged nearly 10 assists per game throughout his career and over 12 assists per game in his highest assisting season. His talent is what helped the Suns reach the finals in the 90s, one of the toughest NBA decades. In 2nd place, and this is tough, but in 2nd place we have Sir Charles Barkley. This is a really close call between Barkley and Nash. If Charles was on the Suns longer, I probably would have had him ahead of Nash. Charles played 4 seasons with the Suns, averaging over 23 points per game. He is a 4-time Suns All-Star and Suns MVP. In his MVP season, he put up over 25 points per game and 12 rebounds per game. Coming in 1st place, we have Steve Nash. Nash played 10 seasons with the Suns and pretty much his entire prime with this franchise. He won 2 MVPs, led the league in assists 5 times while in Phoenix, averaging over 11 per game in his best seasons. He is a 6-time Suns All-Star and made many All-NBA teams. To keep this debate short between Steve and Charles, 2 MVPs is better than 1. Moving on, we have the Thunder, and I'll also factor in the Seattle Supersonics, as that is technically the same franchise. In 10th place, we have James Harden. James only played his first 3 seasons with the Thunder, and had he stayed there longer, he would have easily ranked higher. He didn't make any All-Star team with this franchise specifically, but had much success coming off the bench, winning 6th Man of the Year in 2012, and averaging almost 17 points per game off the bench. Ranking in 9th place is Dennis Johnson. Dennis is a Sonics champion and Finals MVP. He is also a 2-time Sonics All-Star, averaging 19 points per game in his final season with the Sonics. He is an All-Defensive player who would have ranked higher if he played with this team longer, as he only spent 4 seasons in Seattle. Coming in 8th place is Dale Ellis. Dale is a Super Sonics All-Star who averaged over 27 points per game in his best scoring season. He played 7 seasons in Seattle, averaging over 20 points per game overall there. He is also the 1987 Most Improved Player, who helped this team reach the playoffs 5 times. I have Dale ahead of Dennis because while Dennis is a Finals MVP, I think he had a much better team built around him. Dale was able to bring success to a franchise with far less talent by his side and was a much better scorer. In 7th place, we have Sean Kemp. Sean played his first 8 seasons in Seattle and is a 5-time Sonics All-Star who averaged 16 points per game while on the Sonics and over 19 points per game in his highest scoring season. He is a 3-time All-NBA player who helped lead his team to the playoffs 7 times and even to the Finals where they lost to the GOAT MJ. Ranking in 6th place is Jack Sikma. Jack is a Hall of Fame player who spent his first 9 seasons playing in Seattle. He averaged over 16 points per game and nearly 20 points per game in his highest scoring season with the Sonics. He is a 7-time All-Star, NBA champ, All-Rookie player, and All-Defensive player. I have Jack ahead of Dennis because Jack spent the majority of his career while in the Sonics uniform. In 5th place, we have a Super Sonics lifer, Fred Brown. Fred played all 13 seasons with the Super Sonics, and in his highest scoring season, he put up over 23 points per game. He's an All-Star and an NBA champ who was able to have success in 2 NBA eras. He played both before and after the 3-point line was introduced to the league, and besides, places 8 through 5 are extremely close, but being a team lifer and dominating in 2 eras is what gives Fred the slight edge. Ranking in 4th place is Ray Allen. Ray played pretty much the peak of his prime in Seattle, spending 5 seasons in Seattle. He averaged over 24 points per game while in Seattle and over 26 points per game in his highest scoring season. He is a 4-time Seattle Supersonics All-Star and All-NBA player who led this team to the second round in the playoffs and lost to the Spurs in a tough 6 games. Coming in 3rd place is Gary Payton. The Glove played his first 13 seasons in Seattle and had done some amazing things there. In his highest scoring season, he put up over 24 points per game and was a steals champ in 1996, averaging nearly 3 steals per game. He is a Sonics Defensive Player of the Year, 9-time All-Star, 9-time All-NBA player, 9-time All-Defensive player, All-Rookie player, helped this team reach the playoffs 10 times, and helped this team reach the finals where they came up short against the GOAT of the game, MJ. In 2nd place is Russell Westbrook. Russ played the majority of his career with the Thunder, a total of 11 seasons. He's an 8-time Thunder All-Star, 8-time All-NBA player, 2-time scoring champ, putting up over 31 points per game in 2017, and a 2-time assist champ, averaging over 10 assists per game in his final 4 seasons with the Thunder. Russ was the 2017 MVP, where he insanely averaged a triple-double for that entire season. Last but not least, in 1st place, we have the Slim Reaper, Kevin Durant. Kevin spent his first 9 seasons playing with the Thunder and technically Supersonics in his rookie season. KD is a Rookie of the Year, regular season MVP, 7-time All-Star, 7-time All-NBA player, 4-time scoring champ with the Thunder, averaging over 30 points per game in multiple seasons. KD took this team to the playoffs 6 times and led them to the finals in 2012, averaging nearly 29 points per game in that postseason. Next up, we have the Timberwolves, and in 10th place is Wally Szczerbiak. Wally played the first 7 seasons with the Timberwolves, averaging over 15 points per game and roughly 20 points per game in his best scoring season. He's a 1-time All-Star, All-Rookie player who helped this team reach the playoffs 5 times. Ranking in at 9th place is Tony Campbell. Tony played 3 seasons in Minnesota, and his time with the Timberwolves compared to any other team during his 9 seasons were night and day. With the Wolves, he averaged over 20 points per game, and everywhere else, he couldn't crack over 10 points per game. While he didn't make an All-Star team, he played at an extremely high level. Coming in at 8th place is Terrell Brandon. While Terrell is a 2-time Cleveland All-Star, he played near his All-Star level during his 4 seasons with the Timberwolves. He scored over 17 points per game in his best Wolf seasons. He helped the Wolves make the playoffs 3 times and averaged nearly 20 points per game during his first postseason runs and 18 points per game overall. In 7th place, we have Pooh Richardson. Pooh is an All-Rookie player who played his first 3 seasons with the Timberwolves. While he didn't make an All-Star team, he played like one. As in his 2nd season, he averaged over 17 points per game and 9 assists per game, nearly averaging a double-double. I have Pooh above Terrell and Tony because he was quite the Iron Man, playing all 82 games for every season and suited up for the Timberwolves, also performing at a high level as well. Ranking in 6th place is Sam Cassell. Sam only played 2 seasons with the Timberwolves, but did quite a bit in a short amount of time. He was able to make an All-Star team and average over 17 points per game and almost 20 points per game in his best scoring season with the Wolves. He was able to help the team reach the playoffs and average over 16 points per game in the postseason, making it to the Western Finals. At 5th place, we have Al Jefferson. Al only played 3 seasons in Minnesota, but played some of his best seasons there. He averaged over 20 points per game and 11 rebounds per game. The walking double-double never made an All-Star team, but certainly played at an All-Star level. Coming in at 4th place, we have Karl-Anthony Towns. Cat only completed 5 seasons so far and will likely end up higher on this list in the future. He is a 2-time Timberwolves All-Star, Rookie of the Year, All-Rookie player, and All-NBA player who averages over 22 points per game. He would be higher on this list already if he got to more playoff appearances or had deeper playoff runs, but he should end up higher on the list in the future regardless. Ranking in 3rd place is Jimmy Butler. While Jimmy only played one full season and technically 1.5 seasons with the Wolves, he did some pretty impressive things for this team. He was the main reasons why the Wolves got into the playoffs in 2018, and the fact that they missed the playoffs when he left speaks for itself. He also made an all-star team during his full season with the Wolves and averaged over 22 points per game in that season. Now it's time to find out which Kevin is better. In second place, we have Kevin Love. Love played his first 6 seasons in Minnesota, averaging over 19 points per game and over 26 points per game in his best scoring season. He is a 3-time Wolves All-Star, All-NBA player, most improved player, and a rebounding champ, as he averaged an insane 15.2 rebounds per game in 2011. Hopefully to no one's surprise, at first place is Kevin Garnett. Garnett played his first 12 and final 2 seasons with the Timberwolves, and has done some amazing things for this franchise. He made 10 All-Star teams, made many All-NBA and All-Defensive teams, and of course won a regular season MVP in his 2004 season. Moving on, we have the Portland Trail Blazers. Coming in 10th place is Rasheed Wallace. Rasheed is a player you love to have on your team but hate to play against. There is no in between. He spent 8 seasons in Portland, averaging nearly 17 points per game and almost 20 points per game in his best scoring seasons. He's a 2-time Portland All-Star who helped the team reach 7 playoffs. Ranking in 9th place is CJ McCollum. CJ is a really underrated player, and in the future, he should be up higher on this list. He spent his whole career so far in Portland, and while he hasn't been selected to an All-Star team, he has played at an All-Star level as he averaged over 20 points per game in his last 5 seasons. He's also the 2016 Most Improved Player, jumping from 6.8 points per game to 20.8 points per game. In 8th place, we have Maurice Lucas. Mo the Enforcer played 5 seasons with Portland, averaging over 15 points per game and over 20 points per game in his best scoring season. He is a 3-time Portland All-Star, All-Defensive Player, and 1977 NBA champ, averaging 20 points per game in the finals. Ranking in 7th place is Brandon Roy. Brandon had a short but successful career. He only played 5 seasons in Portland and averaged nearly 19 points per game and over 22 points per game in his best scoring season. He is a 3-time All-Star, 2-time All-NBA player, Rookie of the Year, and helped his team reach the playoffs 3 times, averaging over 26 points per game in his best postseason. Had his knees held up, and had he had better health, he could have ended up much higher on this list if he played longer. He had so much potential. In 6th place is Jeff Petrie. Jeff played his entire career in Portland and scored nearly 25 points per game in his best scoring season and 21 points per game overall. He won Rookie of the Year, became a 2-time All-Star, made an All-Rookie team. If Jeff was healthier, he would have had a much longer and more successful career. His career was cut short at 28 due to a knee injury. Had his health kept up, he would have ended up higher on this list. Ranking in 5th place is LaMarcus Aldridge. Aldridge played his first 9 seasons in Portland, averaging nearly 20 points per game there and over 23 points per game in his highest scoring regular season. He is a 4-time Portland All-Star, 3-time All-NBA player, All-Rookie player, and helped his team to 5 postseasons, averaging over 26 points per game in his best postseason, making it to the second round. In 4th place, we have Terry Porter. Terry played his first 10 seasons in Portland, averaging nearly 15 points per game and over 18 points per game in his best scoring seasons. He's a 2-time Portland All-Star, but played at an All-Star level much longer. He helped his team reach the playoffs all 10 times and even helped them reach the finals twice. While they came up short in the finals, Portland was facing a tough Pistons team and the GOAT MJ and the Bulls. Landing in 3rd place is Bill Walton. Bill could easily be number 1 on this list had he not ran into injuries or played in Portland for longer. He played his first 4 seasons with the Trailblazers, averaging over 17 points per game, making 2 All-Star teams, and his 3rd season led the league in rebounds and blocks, averaging over 14 rebounds per game and 3 blocks per game. He won a regular season MVP in 1978 and a finals MVP in 1977, and of course is a Portland champion. In 2nd place is Damian Lillard. This is a close call between Damian and Bill, and I have Damian just a slight edge over Bill Walton. Lillard so far is a Portland lifer who won Rookie of the Year, made 5 All-Star teams and 5 All-NBA teams so far. In his latest season, he put up over 30 points per game, and while Bill has the better resume so far, Lillard, in my opinion, has more on-court talent, more health, and is someone I would rather draft first since he has the health to play longer and more consistently. Coming in 1st place is easily Clyde Drexler. Clyde played his first 12 seasons in Portland, making 8 All-Star teams, 5 All-NBA teams, and averaged over 27 points per game for many seasons during his prime in Portland. While he won a ring with the Rockets, he led the Trailblazers to 11 postseasons and 2 finals, coming up short in both of them. Regardless, Clyde is still a franchise-level Hall of Fame player. Next up, we have the Golden State Warriors, and in 10th place, we have Draymond Green. On many other teams, Draymond would rank higher than 10, but when your franchise is loaded with many legends, making the top 10 is a compliment in of itself. Draymond is a three-time All-Star, three-time champ, steals champ, two-time All-NBA, five-time All-Defensive, and 2017 Defensive Player of the Year. In ninth place, we have Baron Davis. Davis played four seasons with the Warriors and averaged over 20 points per game. He also led the league in steals while playing for the Warriors. While he made All-Star teams playing for other teams, he did play at an All-Star level during his time with the Warriors. I have Baron Davis ahead of Draymond because Baron was the best player on his team during that time and led that team to the playoffs. Whereas Draymond, I don't know if we can count him as a walking All-Star. He certainly wasn't the best player on his teams. Draymond is more of a system All-Star. Ranking in eighth place is Nate Thurmond. Nate the Great is a Hall of Fame legend who played 11 seasons with the Warriors. He is a seven-time All-Star, five-time All-Defensive player, All-Rookie player, who averaged over 17 points per game and 21 points per game in his best scoring season. He helped lead this team to six postseasons. Coming in seventh place is Klay Thompson. If Klay gets back to shape and continues to play at a high level, he will likely end up higher on this list one day. Thompson is a five-time All-Star, three-time champ, two-time All-NBA player, All-Rookie player, All-Defensive player. He has averaged 19 points per game throughout his career so far, and over 22 points per game in his best scoring season. Landing in sixth place is Paul Arizin. Paul is a Philly Warriors lifer, Hall of Fame player, Rookie of the Year, 10-time All-Star, NBA champ, four-time All-NBA player, two-time scoring champ, and an All-Star MVP. His best scoring season, he averaged over 25 points per game. In fifth place, we have Chris Mullin. Chris spent most of his career with the Warriors, playing 13 seasons with them. He is a Hall of Fame player who is a five-time All-Star, four-time All-NBA player, averaged over 25 points per game for five straight seasons, and over 20 points per game overall in his career with the Warriors. Chris led his team to five playoffs in the 90s, one of the toughest eras of basketball. Coming in fourth place is Rick Barry. Rick played most of his career with the Warriors, a total of eight seasons. He averaged over 25 points per game and over 30 points per game in his best scoring seasons. He's an eight-time Warriors All-Star, scoring champ, NBA champ, NBA Finals MVP, Rookie of the Year, and six-time All-NBA player. If Rick wasn't competing with many other MVPs going forward, he would have ranked number one on this list. In third place, we have Kevin Durant. KD only played three seasons with the Warriors, but has accomplished so much in so little time. He's a three-time Warriors All-Star, two-time Finals MVP, two-time champ, three-time All-NBA player, went to three straight finals, and averaged over 25 points per game and over 26 points per game in his final two seasons with the Warriors. If KD stayed in Golden State, he could have ended up higher on this list. Ranking in second place is Steph Curry. Steph is a six-time All-Star, 2016 scoring champ, three-time NBA champ, two-time MVP, a unanimous MVP, six-time All-NBA player, a steals champ, and if this next player wasn't a potential GOAT of the game itself, he would have ranked number one on this list. If Curry continues to play at an elite level and finishes his career in Golden State, it is possible he could end up taking number one on this list, but it won't be easy. As in first place, we have Wilt Chamberlain. Wilt played his first three seasons with technically the Philadelphia Warriors and two and a half seasons with the San Francisco Warriors, about six seasons in total. He averaged an insane 41 points per game and 50 points per game in his best scoring season. Just absolute video game numbers. There may never be a player to put up these averages ever again. He averaged over 27 rebounds per game in his best seasons, which is unfathomable for most, if not all, NBA players. Wilt is an MVP, All-Star, All-NBA player, rebounding champ, and scoring champ for the Warriors. And last but not least, we have the Washington Wizards. In 10th place, we have Moses Malone. Moses only played two seasons with the Wizards, and if he was on this team longer or had the peak of his prime with the Wizards, he would have been much higher on this list. In his two seasons, he did make two All-Star teams and averaged 22 points per game. In 9th place, we have Antoine Jameson. Antoine played six seasons with the Wizards and pretty much the majority of his prime there. He averaged over 20 points per game and over 22 points per game in his best Wizards scoring season. He's a two-time Wizards All-Star who helped lead this team to four postseasons. In the 2007 playoffs, he averaged over 32 points per game. Ranking in 8th place, we have Gus Johnson. Gus is a Hall of Fame player who played the majority of his career with the Baltimore Bullets. He is a five-time All-Star, two-time All-Defensive player, four-time All-NBA player, All-Rookie player, and averaged over 20 points per game in his best scoring season. He helped his team get to the playoffs five times, and his deepest run with the Bullets was the conference finals. Coming in 7th place, we have Chris Webber. Chris played four seasons in Washington, his second through fifth seasons averaging over 20 points per game. He made one All-Star team for the Bullets and helped his team get to the playoffs once. While Chris doesn't have the best Wizards resume, he was about to enter his prime, and I think his on-court talent as a walking double-double speaks for itself. In 6th place is Earl Monroe. Earl played his first five seasons with the Baltimore Bullets, averaging over 23 points per game and over 25 points per game in his best scoring season. He won Rookie of the Year, made an All-NBA team, and is a two-time Bullets All-Star. He helped his team get to three playoffs, his deepest run for the Bullets being the conference finals. Landing in 5th place is Bradley Beal. Beal so far has only only a two-time All-Star, but has played at an All-Star level for many more seasons. In his most recent season, he averaged over 30 points per game and averaged over 21 points per game throughout his entire career. He helped his team get to four postseasons, and if he stays healthy and keeps his game up, he could end up higher on this list. In fourth place is Gilbert Arenas. Gilbert played 8 seasons with the Wizards and spent his entire prime with this team. He averaged over 25 points per game overall and nearly 30 points per game in his best scoring season with the Wizards. He is a 3-time Wizards All-Star and 3-time All-NBA player who played like an All-Star for many more seasons. He led his team to 3 playoffs where he averaged 34 points per game in the 2006 playoffs. Landing in third place is Elvin Hayes. The Big E played 9 seasons with the Bullets and pretty much his entire prime. He averaged over 21 points per game and over 23 points per game in his best Bullets season. He's a 7-time Bullets All-Star, Bullets champion, 6-time All-NBA player, and 2-time All-Defensive player. Coming in second place is John Wall. While John Wall and Russell Westbrook recently swapped teams via a trade for the 2021 season, we have yet to see them on the court for their new teams in a full season. For now, John has played 9 full seasons with the Wizards, averaging 19 points per game and over 23 points per game in his best scoring season. He's a 5-time All-Star, All-NBA player, All-Rookie player, All-Defensive player. John is one of the fastest players in the NBA, an amazing athlete, and has led his team to 4 playoff appearances, averaging over 27 points per game in his highest scoring postseason. In first place, hopefully to no one's surprise, we have Wes Unseld. Wes is a Bullets lifer, 5-